I'm happy to call this movie Happy Wheels. I'm happy to call this movie Babe, Furiosa in the City. And I'm happy to call this movie Max, Mad in the City.
I mean, Fast and Furiosa takes it, dude. Come on.
Muncher.
In a world filled with war, hate, suffering, and Justin Bieber, two guys fix it all with a battle about a movie. One film, two opinions, one coin, two sides. They feud. You decide. It's time for Film Feud.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Film Feud, the podcast where we debate whether top-rated movies should be top-rated. I'm Vidur.
And I'm Vikram.
Hi, Vikram.
Hey, Vidur. How's it going?
Good, good, good. Ready to feud?
Always.
Mind telling the good folk, our pleasant listeners, what we're doing here?
With pleasure. So we take a movie from the IMDb top 250, we toss a coin, heads argues for and tails argues against.
Exciting. After that, we feud and you, the listeners, get to decide who you think won. You can vote on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, at Film Feud Pod. Let us know who you think won. Let us know what arguments you might have made. Let us know what movie you want us to feud next.
You guys can also find more episodes on our website, munchermedia.com.
And the movie we are feuding this week that I'm pretty excited to get to is none other than the 2015 action classic surprise bonanza summer fest, Mad Max Fury Road.
Can you repeat all of that again?
Mad Max Fury action summer bonanza.
I'm actually surprised this movie came out in 2015. It's been a while. I thought it was like last year or last year.
I think everybody was surprised this movie came out in 2015 because it was 30 years after the previous Mad Max movie.
Yeah, and apparently George Miller had to struggle quite a bit to get this one out.
Plus he was 70. If I'm making action movies when I'm 70, that's a good life.
Is it?
If I'm making big movies when I'm 50, that's maybe not so good a life, which George Miller also did.
Yeah.
But I'm sure we'll get to it.
Yeah, of course.
First things first, we have to toss them coins, figure out which side we're feuding.
Go for it.
All right. I will be tossing the coin. Heads argues for and tails argues against. Here we go. And it's heads. Yes. Action movie, cult classic, summer bonanza fest, George Miller, 70, beauty, action, Tom Hardy. What a great time in the theater.
I'll be honest, man. I enjoyed this movie a little bit when I saw it the first time.
Aha.
When I saw it the first time in the hall.
Wait. Aha.
Okay. Are you done with the
No, but I'll save the last one.
Okay. I remember seeing it again pretty close to when like a good print came out, like when they released the...
A good print.
Pirate Bay DVD, whatever print. And I didn't enjoy it as much, man.
So basically you had this information locked and loaded that you enjoyed it once and not the second time. But the truth is that I watched it in the theater and I had a mind-blasting time. This movie took everybody by surprise.
Have you rewatched it though after?
No, but I'm super excited to.
Yeah, I think you should do that. And I think you're going to have a tough time.
Yeah, I think you're going to have a tough time. All right, why don't we get to it?
Yeah, let's do it, man. Let's go watch this movie. I'm pretty excited.
I'm pretty pumped. Let's go watch this movie.
I was so right, dude. I was so right about this one. Just be honest, all right? Feud aside, Vidur, we're friends, right? We can have a friendly, honest conversation.
Okay.
You did not like this film as much as you did when you saw it the first time.
That's true.
Don't say you liked it more. Oh, God.
I liked it more.
This is horrible, yeah.
I liked it more because, you know, the movie is such chaotic, anarchic, crazy fun that the first time you watch it, it takes a while to figure out what's going on. This time I knew I could focus on the world building and the amazing detail and the fight scenes. And I knew a little bit more about the history of the movie and the context and George Miller making it. Oh my God. Mostly practical effects. Are you kidding me? This movie is awesome.
I should have prepared myself more before watching it because I obviously only saw it in 2015, both times I saw it. So I was a little out of it in terms of what to expect. But don't you think there's like a certain nuance that should be employed when a movie like this is made? It's literally like an assault on your system.
No, I do not.
Light and sounds like on overdrive the entire time.
And color.
The way he used it isn't warranted, man. And it's used as a means of confusion, especially like the initial 30, 40 minutes. It's probably what a flashbang feels like.
Perfect. It's a flashbang action
Flashbangs
movie.
Are not comfortable.
This movie is like uncomfortably beautiful.
Let's just
take a step back. Sure. I totally disagree. I think the first 30 to 40 minutes of this movie are so good because they take you by surprise. Mostly you expect world building, you know, first act, like premise setting. The premise is set like in 5 minutes and boom, here we go.
There is no premise set, firstly. There's no backstory. There's no character building. There's nothing. You just get thrown into the mix with a lot of thumping and just a lot of lights in your face.
Fine by me, because actually I haven't watched the other Mad Max movies. Maybe I've caught glimpses of it. So I'm not like a Mad Max fan. I don't know the backstory that's implied. And to the point that they have Mad Max's backstory of his wife and son being killed, which goes all the way back to the first movie, they point to it. It's almost like harking back to the original movies more than it is character setting for him. Because he's actually kind of a side character on his own quest, right? Which we'll get to. The first 30 minutes are perfect. Furiosa goes rogue. You just about understand what's happening. You get context for like what these war boys are, what the Immortan Joe world is. Furiosa goes rogue. They enter the sandstorm, crazy chase, and then they survive. That's the first time you get a minute to breathe. What an awesome opening to a movie.
I don't even know. It's like one long car chase. If I wanted to see car chases, I would have seen like Bullet or something again. And it's not even a car chase, right? It's not even one chase. It's a massive ass fucking U-turn.
Bullet car chase is like a Hot Wheels race compared to this movie. I mean,
have you seen Bullet?
I've seen the car chase from Bullet. It's okay.
All right, I'll get to that. But then it's not even like one particular chase. It's just a massive ass U-turn. They go all the way to basically where they wanted to go. And then they decide that they'll just come back all the way.
It doesn't work out. Their plans to see some green planes don't work out. I mean, there's a lot of subversive stuff in this movie. This is just one of them. In the end, they kind of decide to just face the big baddie instead of running away from the big baddie. And Mad Max helps. How perfect is that? This movie is so good. It just surprised everyone, firstly, because I remember a lot of people were kind of hesitant about this movie because, you know, they loved Mad Max. And then the trailer dropped and it looked pretty badass. Then you could kind of tell these were all these practical effects and people weren't exactly used to that. It kind of screamed like digital CGI, especially in the 2015 era. It just sets itself apart. And the fact that it's so brightly colored, like the visuals, George Miller got this guy out of retirement to be the cinematographer, and he just made the movie pop in a way that usually dystopian movies are like, you know, bleakly colored and gray and black and white. I love this movie experience, man. It's just so good. It's so much good filmmaking coming together, which is why it's 98% on Rotten Tomatoes. Which is why I won like 6 Oscars in all the technical categories because it's such a technical marvel. He actually had people vaulting off poles while going down the Australian or maybe African desert.
It was in Namibia, yeah.
Okay, African desert. They actually did all that stuff. Like 80% of all the effects in this movie are practical. Like
side note, they ended up destroying a lot of uncharted land there and they got sued by the government.
Oh, they did? Yeah, in the desert?
Yeah.
Whatever it took, man.
Yeah. I understand your point about the visual stuff, right? They tried to establish the post-apocalyptic world and somewhat succeed visually. And Miller did that well enough in the originals as well. So
you've seen all the originals?
I've seen all the originals, yeah. And he did it for especially the time when the originals were made. He actually ended up doing a pretty good visual job in terms of the setting and the, you know, just creating that post-apocalyptic world. But in a nutshell, this movie is just unnecessary chaos, man, especially for the first 40 minutes. There's no backstory up until Max ends up joining Furiosa in terms of freeing himself from the rig head or the war head. What are those dudes called?
The war boys.
The war boys, right?
Side note, what are the dudes who are being groomed to become war boys called? War pups.
Okay. And then, you know, when everything settles, there's still nothing in terms of like a story. Like it's just literally a U-turn. And that's Mad Max for you, dude. It's 40 minutes of like loud bangs and thumping. And then one giant U-turn. You throw in a bunch of mother's milk, pregnant ladies in like white silk, nosed-up cars, nosed-up ball dudes. Very, that's the movie.
Very subversive. They killed the hot pregnant lady. The whole MacGuffin, who was supposed to be the one they're trying to save, the Rosie Huntington Whitley from Transformers 3, the main one. I think her name was like Anorak the Splendid or something like that.
Yeah,
the one Immortan Joe really cared about.
Or the one who was the most pregnant.
Who was
basically
the most pregnant,
yeah.
Who basically almost had a kid. They killed her. That was so totally unexpected, right? And then also, you know, those 5 ladies that, I keep calling them ladies, I guess they were what? Like
his prisoners, his wives,
captive, forced wives. They all ended up having personalities of their own. That's quite an accomplishment, right? In fact, Nux, the war boy, I mean, his only role arguably was just to, you know, find Valhalla and like kill these people, right? And then he fails at it. He's so, quote, mediocre that he just sucks at what he's trying to do. But he ends up being the most sympathetic character. You learn more about the war boys. They're groomed. They're all terminally ill. You know, they're just doing this to like because they've been brainwashed about this heaven and Valhalla. He ends up being witnessed at the end.
I mean, after like six attempts.
Yeah, whatever it takes, man. I mean, the side characters are actually given characters. And yeah, so you don't understand exactly what's going on, but that's the point. George Miller opened this movie, you know, in movie making terms, it's called In Medias Res, I guess, which is Latin for like in the middle. But he put out four comic books. So the backstory was completely fleshed out. The comic books weren't that well received. But like the story of Immortan Joe, how he was like this colonel in like the pre-apocalyptic era. The story of Nux, you know, his parents abandoned him or something like that in some slave trade. The story of the wives and Furiosa. I mean, all that is fleshed out, but you don't need it. You want to find out, you can go read the comic books. A lot of it is implied by context, but I didn't need it. You just go for the ride, man.
I see what you're saying in terms of opening it in the middle, and he almost succeeds with it, but there are some key elements that need explanation, right? No one's going to read the comics. I didn't even know the comics existed, and I've seen the original trilogy, so I was hoping that I'd have more sort of context going into this movie. But for example, the dead girl that he keeps getting flashbacks of, she is only fleshed out in the comic books, which were written before this movie came out. So that sort of Mad Max's backstory in this particular movie is established in those comic books.
Oh, that's not his wife and kids?
He has a son in the original trilogy.
Oops.
that scary little girl who's telling him to save, she has a story in the comic books only. So they don't flesh that out.
And it doesn't matter. Star Wars does that all the time, doesn't it?
Star Wars fleshes out characters way more than this movie. Barely fleshes out its characters.
It
like barely.
Furiosa
like
is fleshed out.
A line or two. Furiosa is fleshed out because of the importance of her character being fleshed out related to the plot in this movie. Mad Max is not fleshed out at all. Who's Max?
Who cares?
No one who's seen the original trilogy or read the comic books has no idea what Max is, what he does, where he got there.
I don't, yeah.
What
I
the
don't.
Situation in the world is like, why he's hell-bent on doing what he does.
Survive. He said survive. Well, I want to survive.
And dude, then you know the ending, right? The ending. I'm jumping to the ending, but in the ending, they show Max going back towards the wasteland after helping Furiosa and the team succeed in overcoming the Aquacola town
the
or
Citadel.
Whatever. The
Aquacola
Citadel,
town,
right. Yeah. So he goes back. Like, why does he go back? That's so important to establish why Max has the motive of going back and stuff, right?
Okay, I'll tell you what. I'll tell you my concession.
Okay.
In relation to this. It'll take care of everything.
Okay.
The one thing this movie got wrong, very minor,
mm-hmm, I'm sure,
is the name of the movie.
Mad Max Fury Road?
Yeah.
It should be U-Turn.
This movie is not about Mad Max. This movie, Mad Max is just a side character. This movie would have been better off being called Madam Max or Madam Furiosa, Furiosa Fury Road. It's just that Mad Max is the anthology well-known character who happens to feature in the movie. But it's Furiosa's movie, and that's totally fine. So even, for instance, when Mad Max goes and does some badass shit, you know, in the distance when they're waiting for him in the war rig, and he just goes and he comes back with all these weapons and a new steering wheel. I mean, they don't even show him do that, right? If he was a protagonist, they would show him do that. He's the badass. So that takes care of all of it, right? You don't need to know Max's like deep dive character. He just happens to be the point person who's narrating it. And then the rest of it is Furiosa's story.
That's interesting that you said the name should be different. I actually have a follow-up to your concession there. I think this movie should have been called Fast and Furiosa.
Fast and Furiosa is a great name.
Because Fast and Furious did it so much better.
Oh, please.
So much better. And you know another movie that did it so much better? Waterworld. Have you seen Waterworld?
Do you know the biggest bomb of all time for like 50 years?
Have you seen it?
Years?
Watch it again. I'm telling you, it's one of those movies that grows on you that wasn't made in the right time. You watch it right now, you'll actually love it. Guaranteed.
Wasn't it basically a Mad Max ripoff starring Kevin Costner?
No, it's not. Mad Max Fury Road is a Waterworld ripoff.
I don't think so. The best I'll grant you is because I'm a fan of George Miller, because I really like Babe and Babe 2, a very underrated
right.
sequel. And I actually really like Happy Feet as well. I'm willing to grant you a few other titles. I'm happy to call this movie Happy Wheels. I'm happy to call this movie Babe, Furiosa in the City. And I'm happy to call this movie Max Mad in the City.
I mean, Fast and Furiosa takes it, dude. Come on.
Yeah, I will grant you that. Fast and Furiosa is probably the best title, but only because this movie does it better than Fast and Furious.
Any Fast and Furious does it better than this
Come
movie.
Come on, dude. You don't even mean that. You're embarrassing yourself.
100%. This and Waterworld, though, I can't even budge on that, dude. Like, just go, literally go watch Waterworld again. It's because you've seen this movie now, you go watch Waterworld and you'll know what I'm talking about.
Dude, Fast and Furious are like stupid CGI, bad characters. And this is like the most bad has action ever. This movie makes me scared of going to Australia. It wasn't even shot in Australia. I'm just like, oh my god, the Australian desert seems scary as hell. It's like watching automotive carnage.
Automotive carnage.
Yeah.
You know, like, just funny thing about the Australian outback, so where they planned to shoot this movie initially, was basically where they shot the originals as well. And George Miller and the team lined up everything, the crew, the cast and everyone, and they were ready to start shooting. And that place got rainfall for the first time in like 18 years. And then like plants started growing and stuff. And like, yeah, this is not a post-apocalyptic world. So that they wait 18 months, nothing happened. And that's when they ended up going to like Africa to shoot it.
So even after crazy development hell for decades, it took like 10 years just to develop this movie, right?
Yeah, I mean, Tom Hardy got attached to it very late on. I think Jeremy Renner was at the forefront. He was actually very passionate about getting this made. He was doing screen tests and stuff, but that didn't happen. And
I heard George Miller even wanted Heath Ledger before, you know, tragedy.
Sniff.
Did you just sniff out loud?
Yeah.
Wow. I'm just glad it worked out, man. Tom Hardy's kind of perfect, you know, he's like...
Really?
Yeah, because he's like almost like this silent, like, you know...
I think he's wasted in this movie, man.
You mean drunk or...
Oh, no. Tom Hardy's acting potential is wasted.
Yeah,
his caliber.
Every movie doesn't need to be like... I don't know. What movie did he act
well like
in?
He's like a Mr. Bean with muscles, man. He's just grunting all the way through.
That's an interesting point. Because even the first time that George Miller made Mad Max, which, by the way, was one of the most profitable films of all time. Like, he made it for like 250
USD.
Yeah, it
was super, yeah.
He made it for like 250K USD and it made 100 million. I mean, that's insane.
Yeah. Also, what helped him was the Australian to US dollar conversion at that time. Because it was completely set in Australia, shot in Australia and stuff.
Yeah, but it brought Australian cinema to like the front.
Mel Gibson. Dude.
And launched Mel Gibson, of course.
Yeah.
So he made that as essentially a silent film, like a silent film with sound. He used to be obsessed with silent films. Like, he used to go watch drive-in movies, but just be too far away to actually hear the sound so you could watch it for free. And the guy was like a doctor, dude. He just starts making short films and then films. Mad Max was his first feature film. And honestly, 40 years later to make Mad Max Fury Road, it's almost like his whole career was worth it.
I see what you're trying to get here, but you know what a big problem I have with this particular movie is? You know, Fury Road didn't have a script. It didn't have a script.
Yeah, it just had a storyboard. That's perfect.
And that, you can see it.
You
can completely see it.
I see it. And I
not
it.
In a good way.
I think
you're taking it in a good way. It's like the most horrible way. Like, you have to have a script or some semblance of a script to direct your actors. Tom Hardy was super frustrated. He came out multiple times during the production of this movie saying, I have no idea how to execute this guy's vision.
But I already told you, it's a silent movie with sound.
Yeah, it's a silent movie when it wants to be silent, and then it has dialogues when it wants to advance some character sort of creation, and then it's very convenient
that
way. Why
not? Most character creations are advanced without dialogue, but yeah, sure, man. I mean, think about how simple the script is, and that's not a problem. It's a fun action movie, and it still manages the things that a silent movie needs to get right really well, right? So, of course, the action, no-brainer. All the awards that it won, like costumes, production design, I'm not even sure, maybe like editing and sound and all that, but the visuals especially, like, certain things stuck with me now that I was watching it 3 years later from when I first watched it. There were a few scenes that I clearly remembered were coming. I mean, beyond the obvious one, right? Beyond like the poster ones, like Furiosa crying or something. Those you don't forget. But for instance, when Mad Max and Furiosa have their first fight, when he just looks away for like a second. Firstly, the visual of him coming on to these five gorgeous ladies, which till this point haven't really been established. And so, I mean, it just looks stunning, right? And obviously, it's like all five basically models or whatever. And then he's getting one of them to undo his chains. That whole battle is so crazy with Furiosa just coming from behind the camera, you know, like when you don't see her and then she just like spearheads him. Firstly, Furiosa is like striking to kill. I remember watching that in the first movie as well, because they never show that in action movies, you know? It's always like people are sparring with the intention of just knocking each other out at best. She's taking a bolt cutter and she's trying to kill him with every blow. I remember that. And then when the fight ends, when he finally gets the gun and he shoots three bullets around her, those kind of like visual striking elements, like that, they have stuck with me for a long time. And I only realized when I watched this movie again how striking they were.
You've completely overhyped all of these scenes. The only scene that I'll do grant is that Furiosa scene that you spoke about earlier, right? And more so because of the sort of way it was shot. So what ended up happening in that scene was that they planned the entire day to shoot that sequence in terms of Furiosa realizing that her land is gone. And then, you know, her being just like stressed out about it. But they saw like this wind rising. And because it was all sand dunes around them, they realized that within the hour or within like an hour and a half, it would be unusable. And they only had that day to shoot. So that entire take of her taking off her fake arm, walking, slumping to the ground and screaming, that's all one take.
That's crazy.
That's pretty phenomenal, right? And that goes to show that Charlize Theron is a beast as an actor. So
can we just talk about that? She killed it.
I think she was the only good thing about this movie.
She was so good.
She was the only good thing about this movie. And she's the only reason this movie succeeded to whatever degree it did.
That's why they're making a sequel with her. Well-deserved. I mean, she emoted so much with that.
They're planning to. George Miller's suing the studio right now.
Oh, is he? Why?
Because they were owed some $7 million in royalties, which they didn't get or something.
Oh,
so he's literally like, I have two scripts ready, but I'm suing the studio. So you guys will have to wait. Everyone's lined up, good to go.
What are you saying, dude? Yeah. Don't take away a Furiosa sequel because of this.
You know who else I liked in the movies? The old ladies.
The grannies on motorbikes?
Yeah.
Yes.
Dude, I mean, so OG, right?
Let's just take a moment.
Yeah.
Grannies on motorcycles in a post-apocalyptic world, shotgunning bald
war boys. Sniping. The sniper, the main sniper one, dude, so impressed with her. So she's like, one of the wives is like, so you shoot people with that? She's like, yeah, headshots, all of them.
Yeah.
Snap straight at the medulla. good, dude. So good.
Oh my God. This movie, this crazy world-building elements, like it's like a punk rock movie, but yet made believable, again, without even having watched the previous Mad Maxes, which apparently has built up to this point, right? Like, each one gets more apocalyptic and hence crazier. Now it's like purely tribal. But for instance, I looked up what this dude is called, okay? This is like a rock opera going on, right? In this movie with the chase. And the doof wagon. Mm-hmm. Do you know what the doof wagon is?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
A heavy metal amp on wheels, mm-hmm. Drums at the back, kettle drums. It's like a Blumen group going on at the back. And then the front man of it all wearing a red like pajama jumpsuit. Known as the Coma Doof Warrior, hangs from strings and just plays this guitar. It weighed like 130 pounds in real life as a real guitar, double-headed, and shoots flame.
I have a massive-ass problem with depiction of music and the particular music that used in that sequence and generally in this movie, man.
You have a problem with the Doof Warrior? That's impossible.
I hated it. It made me cringe, and that was the one thing I remember when I saw the movie the first time. That's the one thing that made me cringe then as well, right? It's music that's there for a visual appeal than auditory appeal. And even visually, it feels like wasted, right? Everything is so over the fucking top, man. This movie is over the top and it's over the top of that.
I agree. It is over the top.
But that's so unnecessary. The music's not good. Firstly, the music's not good. That music is not good metal music. They try to do this whole industrial metal vibe and it just doesn't play off well at all.
In the apocalypse, it's not going to be good, right? They don't have like a lot to live
Definitely
up to.
Don't defend whether it can be good or not.
Come of course on.
Dude, dire That's situations like saying, is when the best music is produced, by the way, historically.
That's like saying their medicine is not good. Yeah, they live in the apocalypse. You gotta
no,
make
it's
do
not.
What you
That's
have.
That's absolutely not the right correlation. How is medicine and music related?
Oh, we can get into that, man.
No, medicine is resource-based. Music is talent-based.
But both heal. Both heal.
Dude, it's like, you know how Sherlock Holmes said in that movie? It's like, it's so overt, it's covert. Here it's like, it's so overt and you're deaf. That's pretty much what it is, dude.
I'm not denying it's like a concert, dude. Like heavy metal. Like
it is not. Go. You haven't been to a heavy metal concert. Trust me.
No, the movie is like a concert. It's like a rock opera. It's like constantly fast-paced, moving, little moments to breathe, and then here we go again.
What would have been much better? Like I really like the trilogy, the original trilogy, because it was thoughtful. It was like high on concept, right? And this one was just like a Michael Bay version of it. Just like an edited cut scene every second. This movie should have been the fourth part.
Oh, that's why it won best editing, huh?
Yeah, whatever, man. Like, oh, it had 300,000 shots and then his wife did it and she put a female's touch to it. It's all bullshit, okay?
I literally have no idea what you're talking
this
about.
This was an action summer tentpole movie and that's exactly what it was in terms of editing, sound mixing, all of those. People are just shell-shocked and they're like, oh, Oscar de rahe hai. Samajh nahi aa raha Oscar de do. This movie would have been so much better if it would have been a fourth part. Like, don't you think seeing Mad Max as like a 50-year-old kicking ass in the wasteland makes for a much better movie?
No, because I haven't seen the Mad Max movies. I don't care. It's
trust
Mad
me,
Max for
trust
our generation.
Me, it would have been so much better. This movie, I don't even know if it's like a reboot or...
It's not.
What is it? Like, it's a standalone? Like,
yeah,
what is it supposed to be?
It's a standalone continuation. And just the lead character is played by someone else. He has the same backstory.
He has the same backstory?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. He's still Max Rocker Tupinski or whatever the hell his name is.
Yeah. You know what the Hindi version of this movie should have been called?
Wait. Must Max.
Close.
Okay.
Not
wait.
Really.
Main batata hun. Motorcycle Nani.
These are all pretty good, but
okay.
I have something better. Pani De De Plis.
What?
It's literally Pani De De Plis. The dialogues.
Witness me.
He's karma crazy. You know, there's this one dialogue that Nux Maros. He's like, oh, I should be walking with the Immorta, McFeasting with the heroes of all time. What? Dude, McFeasting?
I mean, he's just a little out of it. But, you know, like the lore that they've done, Witness Me is just awesome. We have to use it more in real life. If I'd seen the movie again since then, I would have been doing that already.
I think they overdid it within the movie itself.
I also think a great insult for me to use for you from now on is to call you a blood bag.
A blood bag?
Yeah, which okay. I think was great. That's all you're good for.
Yeah.
What else?
I'll tell you. I have another one. This exchange between Nux and Splendid, when Nux is just hanging off the rig and these guys are trying to push them off. Such high octane, I'm about to die sort of situation. And that dialogue exchange, okay? I noted it down. You're an old man's battle fodder, Nux. We're not to blame. Then who killed the world? Push. What is all of this, yeah?
Who killed the world? You didn't see, even though it's in the comics, but in the backstory, when he enters the vault where he keeps the wives, they say, who killed the world?
I haven't read the comics. No one's read the comics.
I noticed in the movie, I only looked up the comic stuff afterwards. In the movie, that's something that they've written all over the vault where they were kept as slaves.
Like, we won't be your warlord mothers and all.
And the last thing it said was, who killed the world?
Yeah, but then
it's just something they wonder, right? Like, they're in Australia. You know, they have no idea what happened to the world. Mm-hmm. And Immortan Joe professes to be a god. And they have like the sort of critical thought to like push back on that. And obviously these war boys are all brainwashed. So I think it's fine. It added a little bit to the sort of like world building, the backstory of the war boys, but when she had that. Because they are battle fodder.
No, I understand that. But didn't you find it a little conflicting in terms of the tonality of the movie at times, right? Like it was obviously like visually it was trying to go for one thing, which was just the whole post-apocalyptic setting. And then with the main characters, like Furiosa later on, they sort of established in terms of what her background was and stuff like that. Max, they never bothered to do it.
And Immortan Joe is just evil. That's not a problem. He's like the Darth Vader from New York.
Immortan Joe is fine. Immortan Joe is whatever. Like, and just the whole ferocity of his character just goes to establish what his mindset and his goals and motives and all are like. But then in terms of the dialogues, like for the most part, there's not much dialogues. And then when the dialogues do come, they're very offhanded, if that makes sense. They're very imbalanced. They'd be very dramatic or for dramatic effect at times. They'd be very like McFeasting and karma crazy sort of
You're grabbing onto McFeasting, karma crazy, but Nux's best dialogue by far, accompanied with the visual. Firstly, the idea that they like huff themselves with paint, essentially that's silver paint, right?
I have no idea.
Whatever it is, it gets them like messed up high, right? And again, it's just become part of their lore. And then he's so excited that he just goes, what a day. What a lovely day. That stuck with me, man. It's so good.
Yeah.
He's having pretty much the worst day ever and sucking and everything. But he's just so excited to be like revering his god, Immortan Joe. What a day.
Yeah, what a day, right?
Dude, the guy went from making penguins dance and pigs talk.
No. He went from making Mad Max to penguins dance to pigs talk. And the only reason he made penguins dance was because he set up a massive ass studio for making Mad Max reboot. And this project fell through. So he's like, I might as well do something with it. He made Happy Feet.
Well, there we go. What a legend. What a legend, George Miller.
I mean, if he would write a script once in a while, it'd be much better, dude.
Yeah, but when he does, he refuses to play it safe. He just went for it and it worked. Thank God for that. Amazing. What a day. What a film. What a lovely film.
I don't think so, dude. I'm just glad that this one's over with. And I don't think I'll be watching this movie again. Maybe the sequel if it comes out at some point, but yeah, that's about it. And that was this week's episode of Film Feud. Hope you guys enjoyed.
Thank you for listening. Now we feuded and you get to decide who you think won. Don't forget to vote on Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter at Film Feud Pod.
You can also find us on our website, munchermedia.com, and don't forget to rate and review us on iTunes.
We'd love to hear what movies you'd like us to feud next, or any points you might have raised during the feud as well.
That's it for this week. Catch you guys later. Bye-bye.
See ya.